Virginia, and Kentucky. Control of the U.S. Senate hangs in the balance. Republicans need to pick up 6 seats to retake the majority.
36 states will elect governors. Many of those races are so tight. More incumbent governors are at risk of losing this year than any time in the last 2 decades.
Stay with us all night, on air and online, for analysis and the latest results, plus a special report at 11 p.m. Eastern.
It is election night on the PBS NewsHour, and we have a call to projection.
Hi. Lincoln Financial, committed to helping you take charge of your life and become your own chief life officer.
BNSF Railway. And by BAE Systems, inspired work.
And with the ongoing support of these institutions.
This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
The vote counting has begun in what promises to be a long night that could reshape the nation's political landscape. We begin our coverage with how Election Day unfolded, but before we do that, we want to tell you first that we have a projection to make in the race in Kentucky. For the United States Senate, Mitch McConnell, who, if Republicans take over tonight, will be the new majority leader of the U.S. Senate. But for now, he has managed to hold on to his seat against Allison Lundgren Grimes in Kentucky.
That brings him back to Washington.
And that brings him back to Washington for sure. Now we're going to, the vote counting has begun in what promises to be a long night that could reshape the nation's political landscape. We begin our coverage with how Election Day unfolded and what's at stake.
After months of campaign ads, pitched appeals, and hundreds of candidates' debates, Americans headed to the polls today. In some parts of the country, there were long lines. In others, turnout was lighter as voters breezed in to elect officials for national, state, and local offices.
I think that this is what it's all about, to be able to vote and have a voice and hopefully select the people that you think are going to represent the state the most appropriately.
It's really, I think, going to swing things here in North Carolina as well as across the nation. So I thought of it as a very important election to kind of get out here and make my perspective heard.
Up for grabs, 1/3 of the Senate and party control of that chamber, plus all 435 seats in the House, where Republicans are expected to add to their majority. Today, Democrats control the Senate with 53 seats, plus 2 independents who vote with them. Republicans hold 45 seats, but the GOP is hoping to add at least 6 more tonight and shift the balance of power.
Thank you very much.
Senate contenders, incumbents and challengers, Democrats and Republicans, cast their ballots early.
I think we're going to have a good day here in Kentucky and hopefully around the country.
We need people down in Washington that are going to work together with folks, that are going to bring people together to vote. The partisan gridlock, is enough as that.
In Washington, White House Press Secretary Josh Earnest said the election, no matter its outcome, does not constitute a referendum on President Obama's job performance.
It's not. The fact is, the voters, again, the voters who at least picked up the phone to talk to people who are conducting a poll for CNN, indicated that that at least a majority of them were not trying to send a message to the president with their vote, that something else was driving their decision.
In many cases, that something else is the economy, and it's been a major factor in making many of the 36 governors' races very close. This is also the first election for some states with new voter ID rules, and the Department of Justice and various other groups are monitoring for any irregularities, including suppression and voter fraud.
And we have 2 new results, not surprisingly, in South Carolina tonight. The U.S. Senator Lindsey Graham has been reelected, as has Tim Scott, his seatmate, who has also been reelected from South Carolina. Judy.
Neither one of those surprising. Gwen, we're just hearing that Nikki Haley, the governor of South Carolina, also reelected. None of those a particular surprise in the state of the very red state of South Carolina. So now some other news we want to tell you about this evening. There is new evidence that Islamic State militants tortured and abused Kurdish children in northern Syria. Human Rights Watch announced those findings today. Some 150 teenage boys were kidnapped near the embattled town of Kobani in May. The report says they were beaten with rubber hoses and electrical cords and forced to watch beheading videos. All of the captives have now either escaped or been released.
Tensions mounted again today in Ukraine as the government announced it's sending more troops to the eastern part of the country. President Petro Poroshenko said the reinforcements will defend key cities against pro-Russian rebels. Both sides agreed to a ceasefire in September, but it's been violated repeatedly since then.
In Mexico, federal police captured a fugitive former mayor who allegedly ordered an attack on student protesters. 43 of them are missing and feared dead. Early this morning, Jose Luis Abarca and his wife were taken by convoy to the Mexican Attorney General's office after being arrested in Mexico City. Officials said they were giving statements. Parents of the missing students have complained of lack of progress in the investigation, but some of them welcome news of the arrests.
All of us parents heard about the news at dawn. We want to say it's something that cheers us up a bit because we know this was the missing piece. If the federal authorities have completed the jigsaw puzzle, then this means we are closer to finding the students. What happens after they have given their statements will lead us to where they are.
Investigators say the mayor was in league with a drug gang whose members killed the students and buried them in mass graves. But so far, no sign of the bodies has turned up.
The head of Britain's electronic eavesdropping agency is charging that U.S. social media outlets are command and control networks for terror groups. Robert Hannigan made the claim in the Financial Times. He said Islamic State militants use Facebook, Twitter, and WhatsApp to communicate with relative ease. Hannigan says the tech companies are in denial about the issue.
There is word from West Africa that thousands of people have broken Ebola quarantines in Sierra Leone in order to find food. Aid organizations warn today that food deliveries are not reaching many of the remote cordoned off areas. That left hungry people to search where they can, potentially spreading the virus.
The World Health Organization urged today that a prescription drug used to fight drug overdoses may be made more widely available. The UN agency said naloxone could prevent more than 20,000 deaths a year in the U.S. alone. The drug can counter the effects of heroin and some heavy-duty painkillers in minutes, and it can now be administered as a nasal spray.
Minnesota Vikings star Adrian Peterson will avoid jail time for using a wooden switch on his four-year-old son. Peterson pleaded no contest today to a Texas charge of misdemeanor reckless assault. The NFL star initially faced a felony charge, but appeared before a judge in suburban Houston this afternoon and formally accepted the plea deal. He spoke outside the courthouse afterward.
I truly, regret this incident. I stand here and I take full responsibility for my actions. I love my son more than any one of you could even imagine. And I'm looking forward to, and I'm anxious to continue my relationship with my child. I'm just glad this is over.
Peterson has been on paid leave from the Vikings. There was no immediate word on how the plea deal affects his status.
A man long sought for pirating material from the music and movie industries was arrested today in Thailand. Hans Frederik Lennart Nea co-founded the file-sharing website The Pirate Bay. He's already been convicted in Sweden of copyright infringement and sentenced to a year in prison. He and three associates will also have to pay $6.5 million in damages.
Major U.S. banks are joining forces to combat cyber attacks. The Wall Street Journal reports several cybersecurity firms will use money from 16 banks to create faster communication about potential breaches. The move follows attacks last month on computer systems at JPMorgan Chase and other institutions.
The price of oil kept falling around the world today after Saudi Arabia cut prices for U.S. customers. Oil finished near $77 a barrel in New York trading, putting more pressure on energy stocks and Wall Street in general. The Dow Jones Industrial Average managed a small gain, up 17 points to close near 17,384. But the Nasdaq fell 15 points to close at 4623, and the S&P 500 dropped 5 to finish at 2012. There is a lot at stake and a lot to keep our eyes on this election night. Here to help us make sense of it all for the long haul, Shields and Gerson, that syndicated columnist Mark Shields and Washington Post columnist Michael Gerson. We're hearing already Mitch McConnell won re-election. That man survives even when people say he's in trouble.
He's remarkably resourceful. I mean, it was 1984 when he was first elected. Here he's on his sixth term and about to reach apparently the highest prize of his career, the possibility of becoming majority leader of the U.S. Senate.
But earlier in this cycle, Michael, Allison Lundergan Grimes, the daughter of a prominent Democrat in the state of Kentucky, somebody whose family was very close to Bill and Hillary Clinton, and by the way, she had them in the state, I think, a dozen times between the two of them, she was posing a threat. She was even running ahead of him in the polls at one point.
Well, I think that Democrats are hoping in a couple of these races that good candidates, and I think she's a good candidate, early money and get out the vote efforts could make a real difference, and it didn't in this case. That may indicate some broader problems for Democrats in this. But I agree with Mark here. This is a man who is not necessarily cuddly, but he is very relentless in the way that he practices politics. Ran a tough campaign against his opponent, and an effective one.
The South Carolina outcomes were not surprising, but are there any tea leaves surfacing from these early states that tell us what direction we're heading in for the rest of the night?
Well, I think the South Carolina is interesting in the sense that there were two African Americans running for the Senate against each other. And Tim Scott becomes the first African American elected. Therefore,
he had been appointed.
He had been appointed, and he was elected, and he becomes the elected African American Republican in the United States Senate. I think that it's the early indications are not encouraging for Democrats. I think the Kentucky question is interesting because we've seen states like West Virginia and Kentucky become more Republican in the past 10 years. And Bill Clinton carried Kentucky both times. I think there may be a reconsideration, a recalibration on Hillary Clinton's part, if in fact she does run in 2016, whether Kentucky, even though its affection, residual affection for the Clintons is obvious and widespread, whether in fact that's a target of opportunity.
And in fact, I didn't mean to interrupt. I was just going to say to Michael that it's an interesting question because clearly Grimes thought having the Clintons there, she wanted nothing to do with the president. She wouldn't even say whether she'd voted for him or not. But she really felt that having the Clintons there might give her a boost.
Yes, but Democrats in a state like Kentucky are just facing tremendous headwinds from the wrong track, which is, badly in the wrong direction for Democrats, and the president's popularity, which is a drag in these races. I don't think she's necessarily a weak candidate. You don't have to conclude that out of a race like this. I think she just faced an impossible broader atmosphere, political atmosphere.
But she handled the Obama question so badly.
Well, about the vote.
And we have the night is young.
Okay.
We get
right.
a chance to come
okay.
back to this.
Okay.
But throughout this night, we do want to look at some of the key dynamics and some historical background that's driving this year's elections. Let's start with our political director, Domenico Montanaro, and a central 2014 plot line, that is the Republican advantage.
The big question tonight, will Republicans take control of the U.S. Senate? They need 6 seats to pull it off. So what will happen? Spoiler alert, we don't know. But we can tell you this, there's a reason this man is smiling. Republicans have the advantage going in. Here's why. First, the map. Take a look at this year's 17 competitive Senate races. The vast majority, seen in blue, are held by Democrats, so they have far more seats to defend. Another Republican advantage?
Thank you, North Carolina.
Many of those competitive states went Republican 2 years ago, choosing Mitt Romney over Barack Obama by an average of 17 points. Okay, that's where. But Republicans also have an advantage in who. About a third fewer people vote in the midterms than in presidential years. And the groups that stay home the most are core Democratic voters, African Americans, Hispanics, young voters, and single women. Consider unmarried women, a group that votes 2-1 for Democrats, dropped from 23% of the electorate in 2008 to 21% in 2010. Doesn't sound like much, but that represented 10 million fewer single women who went to the polls. Finally, there's the national environment and President Obama. About two-thirds of Americans say the country is on the wrong track. People are in a pessimistic mood, and when that happens, voters tend to blame the party in power. President Obama's job approval ratings are the lowest of his presidency, sitting at about 40%. And when a president's approval rating is under 50%, his party, on average since World War II, has lost roughly 6 seats during the midterms. And how many seats do Republicans need again to take control of the Senate? That's right, 6.
To get a sense of what's happening on the ground in some of the key states we're watching tonight, we'll be turning to Hari Srinivasan all night. He's upstairs in our newsroom where he'll be touching base with reporters around the country. Hari.
Thanks, Gwen. The polls have closed in Georgia. It was a hotly contested Senate race. Both candidates with family names prominent in Peach State politics, Republican Dave Perdue and Democrat Michelle Nunn. And in the governor's race, the grandson of a former president. Celeste Headley of Georgia Public Broadcasting joins us from Atlanta with the latest. So what's turnout been like?
It's been spotty. There have been anecdotal reports of polling stations that have lines over an hour long, and there's also been reports of polling stations where you could walk right in and cast your vote. At this point, we're not really sure what turnout could be, and as you probably have heard, everything hinges on turnout in Georgia tonight.
Yeah, any voting irregularities for those polling stations where there are such long lines?
Yes. So far, we've heard some reports, and there have been videos posted online of well over an hour-long waits, especially in highly African-American districts, highly minority districts. We also had an odd occurrence where some signs started showing up around Atlanta that said, vote in the election on November 5th. At this point, these are all things that are going to have to be investigated in days to come. But as you know, sometimes when there's irregularities on election, they can affect an election, and there's really nothing that you can do about it.
All right. Let's talk a little bit about the race for the Senate between Michelle Nunn and David Perdue. What's driving voters to the polls?
What's driving voters to the polls? I think there's a real sense in Georgia right now that Georgia could help determine who controls the U.S. Senate. And that's at least driving a number of voters that they don't want either the Democrats to keep control or they don't want the Republicans to take over. And that's certainly motivating people. Another thing that's going on right now is that there's a real changing face of Georgia. The demographics of Georgia are changing even faster than people had predicted. Nobody expected the Democrats to have a chance in this state until 2018 or 2020. So right now, you're really seeing a lot of new voters who've been recently registered. And for many of them, this is their first time voting. Some of them are immigrants. Some of them are not. But in some cases, it's just a passion for actually casting a vote that they haven't done before.
Okay, how about the race for governor? We know the last name. It's the grandson of President Jimmy Carter. Has the last name worked for or against Jason, the grandson, against the current Governor Nathan Deal?
That's kind of the $64,000 question in Georgia, Hari. I think that's been a real kind of a balancing act for Jason Carter. President Jimmy Carter, former president, is very popular as an ex-president. His time in office was not entirely popular in this very red state. So in many ways, Jason Carter's had tried to distance himself from the Carter family name, mm-hmm. and he's very, very lightly touched on his family's experience in politics, which is unfortunate. You can imagine that were Chelsea Clinton to run, I'm sure she would probably bring Bill and Hillary out as often as she could.
Right.
But to be frank, Hari, this is another race in which people expected Nathan Deal to win with 65-70% of the vote. Nobody expected Nathan Deal, who's never lost a race before, to have this kind of problems in his reelection.
All right. We'll check in with you later tonight as well. Celeste Headley of Georgia Public Broadcasting joining us from Atlanta. Thanks so much.
My pleasure.
All right, Gwen, back to you.
Thanks, Hari. We've talked about the dynamics that are driving Republicans to the polls tonight, but what, if anything, is moving Democrats? Political editor Lisa Desjardins is here with that.
Sure, the political talk this year is all about the Republican advantage, but Democrats have a few advantages themselves. Here's three. One, their family names.
I'm Mary Landrieu, and I approve this message.
In Louisiana, incumbent Mary Landrieu included her well-known father, former New Orleans mayor Moon Landrieu, in three ads. Nearby in Arkansas, Mark Pryor's dad is in an ad. He was a congressman, senator, and governor. And finally, Alaska's Mark Begich is reminding voters of his father, a congressman who died in a plane crash. Now, family can be powerful, but another word is helping Democrats, too. Independent.
I'm as independent as South Dakota.
In South Dakota, former U.S. Senator, cowboy poet, and one-man campaign Larry Pressler is captivating the crowds. And in Kansas, first-time candidate Greg Orman is appealing to voters who want a fresh face. Neither man has said who they would caucus with in the Senate, but both independents are threatening their state's Republican candidate in races that Republicans thought were guaranteed. Even if both of those independents lose, they have forced Republicans to spend money to keep bright red seats. And that is the potential third advantage for Democrats, money. Not the amount necessarily, but how they're spending it. Democrats have targeted tens of millions of dollars to get what they hope will be tens of millions of voters to the polls. They have software to ID the voters. They also have programs to make sure they cast ballots. That worked in 2012 for President Obama. Democrats are crossing their fingers that it translates to congressional races as well.
And Georgia, thank you, Lisa. Georgia is just one state we're watching where the polls have already closed. We just want to say to our audience, we're looking at numbers that are starting to come in, Gwen, from polls that have closed in three more states where we haven't called the race. That's Virginia, closed at 7 o'clock. Georgia closed at 7, results coming in. And the state of Vermont, no winner to project there. These are very, very early numbers. But Mark and Michael are with us. Does it say something, Michael, that it's what, a few minutes after 7 and nothing is coming in from Virginia, where Mark Warner, the incumbent Democrat...
says a lot. If we see tonight that Virginia's close, if we see New Hampshire's close, if we see North Carolina's close, that's an indication that the swell, the Republican swell, is more of a wave. So...
I'd like to ask you guys. Go ahead, Mark.
Yeah, I would disagree with Michael about New Hampshire, because I think New Hampshire's always been close the last month there. Mark Warner in Virginia would be. He was expected to win rather easily.
So. One of the interesting things about this election so far is that the president has become his own meme in this election. He gave an interview this afternoon in which he said this was the worst possible group of states for Democrats since Dwight Eisenhower. Is that true?
It is a very tough map. This represents his victories. This is the flip side of his victories 6 years ago. The Republicans only have to take the red states in order to get back control. So I think it's true, but it sounds a little bit self-excusing in this, because the president himself is weighing down many of his own candidates. It's not entirely separate from him, not just the geography.
And it's also interesting, this comes a day after Vice President Biden tried to put the best face on what they were looking at, saying he thought they were going to hold the Senate.
Well, it wasn't exactly a surprise that these states were up. Right. I mean, we know the states are going to be up 6 years from now, 4 years from now, 2 years from now. But the calendar is so important. I mean, these people all won in a great year for Democrats when Barack Obama became, other than Franklin Roosevelt and Lyndon Johnson, the only Democrat in history to win more than 50.1% of the national popular vote, something he did twice in a row. So these Democrats were the beneficiaries of his momentum in 2008 and his draft right down, his undertow in 2014, they're paying for. The flip side of that is the governors. The governors who are up right now in those blue states that were there are Republican governors like Michigan and Florida and Pennsylvania. They won in 2010, 4 years ago, which was a great Republican year. Right. So it comes down to great degree what year you were lucky enough or unlucky enough to run in.
What seats? Sure. What races have you at the edge of your seat tonight, Michael?
Well, I think Iowa is going to be very important. That's a case where if you look at some of the recent polls, between 2012 and 2014, Barack Obama lost in approval, presidential approval, 23 points among women in Iowa. Mm-hmm. That indicates the you know, the problem that Democrats have in this environment. And Iowa is a true swing state. It does predict, you know, 2016 trends. So that will be very interesting to me tonight.
For sure. It's and the other, the added part of that is that that's, as you said, that's where Obama got his lift, his first lift, the big, launched him
the opening
into the presidency.
In 2008. It was a dramatic moment when he beat both John Edwards and Hillary Clinton.
And Hillary Clinton.
Third.
That's right. Well, the night continues. One trend we want to talk about in recent midterm elections has been a sharp drop-off among young voters. That got us thinking about how the next generation of voters sees this election. So in collaboration with our student reporting lab, we spoke with high school students around the country. Our political reporter and editor Lisa Desjardins began the conversation by asking them to look at this year's ads.
So go ahead and hit spacebar on that.
All right. We sat down with teens from our student reporting labs in three states with high-profile Senate contests, Kentucky, Michigan, and Colorado.
I'm Terry Lynn Land.
The idea? To understand how this generation sees campaign ads and politics.
Think about that for a moment.
This has not, like, helped me choose who I want to vote for at all.
We learned they are not impressed.
Because, like, I don't know what to believe. It was two completely different facts trying to state the same thing, but they were completely different. It didn't make any sense. I don't know what to believe, what not to believe.
I sort of tune out ads that are always about what the other opponent is doing wrong or what the other opponent is saying. Because if you really believe in these things and if you really believe that you can help other people, you should talk about the things that you can do to help other people.
The argument is that people, young people might not be voting as much as older people, but they in fact are engaged and committed and a fine generation politically. It's just that they're expressing their politics using different methods or means.
Jan Leakley is a political science professor at American University who specializes in voter turnout and what motivates different groups. She sees a young group right now that cares about issues, but not politics. This, when political parties are launching ads, writing blogs, and trying all manner of methods to get young people in their tents.
I get emails, probably like five a day, from the Democratic Party trying to get me to participate when I think a lot of the process is lost in just campaigning. I think it's based in putting money into ads like this and just trying to get votes instead of trying to get policy changed.
So they are coming of age where they see a politics of polarization and personalization and a lot of big problems and a perception of gridlock and the government not doing its job. And they don't want to engage.
We learned something else, too, about what young people do trust. To use a trendy word, they curate their information. They trust sources they themselves find and know.
I think campaign ads put this almost like a plastic cover over who they are. You don't know who they are because they're aiming to please. But I think the real way to choose who you vote for is to do your own research. And I think that means going to different news websites or magazines or stations, watching them.
I prefer to get a real real information, not just a biased argument on TV that often seems, you know, everybody's saying what other people are saying is untrue, so then it leads me to not trust anyone. So I prefer to read online or find out from sources I trust.
There is a real sense of the end game with these young people. Do campaigns mean anything? Their answer seems to be no. Does voting matter? Depends on whom you ask.
If I'm voting, I'm putting my input into something that could make a difference in my community. There are several things that can change, and I feel like if I'm trying to put forth an effort to help change those things, something could happen.
So, no to any campaigns which lose with young voters tonight. This group wants facts, and they want results. Lisa Desjardins, PBS NewsHour.
Tonight's outcomes could broaden the definition of winner and loser. There are also major issues hanging in the balance. Tonight, we look at prospects for two of them. First, immigration. Joining us are two activists intimately involved on both sides of the issue of who gets to come to the U.S., who gets to stay, and who gets sent back. Brad Botwin is director of Help Save Maryland, a group that wants to tighten the nation's borders. And Christina Jimenez is co-founder of United We Dream, which works on behalf of undocumented immigrants. Welcome to you both. Ms. Jimenez, the movement on immigration reform is basically ground to a halt in Congress and at the White House. What would this election do to change that?
Well, I think that what's going to be critical here is that whatever the outcomes are for these elections will have a lot of impact for 2016. So the question is, would Democrats and the president continue to deport people? Will the president take administrative or executive action on immigration as he promised on June 30th? And or will Republicans continue to promote a mass deportation agenda as they did with Mitt Romney and have continued to do so?
Brad Botwin, is it a mass deportation agenda we're talking about?
I don't believe so. I think tonight we will see the Senate flip to Republican, which is actually a good thing for the immigration issue because you will have a more logical approach. I think the president and the Democrats in the Senate tried to do effectively another Obamacare for immigration, just a mass bill. With the Republicans in charge of the Senate and the House, I think you'll get a step-by-step process. And this will mean, first off, border security. Let's turn off the leaks. Let's seal the border. Internal security. And eventually, over time, after this happens, I think we can get to groups that are pushing these so-called Dreamers and others.
Well, let's take it one step at a time. Do you both agree that comprehensive immigration as a result of tonight's election results is off the table?
What I think it's urgent for immigrant communities is that the president has made a promise to address immigration, because what we saw in 2013 and even this year is that Republicans were unwilling to work on an immigration reform bill that was passed by the Senate. And very clearly, as Speaker Boehner said, that they won't move forward on immigration. And what we've rather seen is Republicans time after time voting to defund programs like the Deferred Action for Child Arrivals program, for example.
Except that a lot of people on your side of the issue are disappointed in the president, too, for not acting.
Exactly. It has been a big disappointment that he actually chose and made a political calculation, thinking that he will rather protect some of the Senate races and the folks running for the Senate races instead of taking action on immigration as he had promised. And I think that based on the outcomes of tonight, we will see whether the White House made a good decision or a decision that actually demobilized voters.
Well, let me ask Mr. Botwin about this idea of executive action, the president stepping in and overruling Congress, essentially, on some of these issues.
Bring it on, Mr. President, bring it on. I think this year, with the Central American tidal wave coming in, the so-called children and their families just walking across the border destroyed the thoughts of having a secure border. Absolutely destroyed it. And Democrats and Republicans came forward and said, enough of this nonsense. We need to do something comprehensive, but we need to do it in steps. So again, the Obamacare analogy, I think, is just perfect. Don't blow the whole thing up. Let's stop the problem of people just wandering in. And, you know, immigrants don't decide who comes here. The American people decide who can come here and how many can come here.
Christina Jimenez, you are an undocumented immigrant yourself. Mm-hmm. Why don't you respond to that?
Well, you know, what we say to people and what we have been pushing the president to do and Democrats and Republicans to think about is that as many immigrants have come throughout the history of the United States, my family came from Ecuador when I was 13 years old, seeking a better life. We were in a situation where we had no food, no money to pay for school. And my parents' dream was so that I can come here and pursue those dreams, because they knew that in this country, those dreams could be achievable. And that's what I did. I'm the first one in my family to graduate from college. I grew up undocumented, and I love this country. For me, this is my country. And
Mr. Botwin says it's not up to you to decide whether it's your country.
Well, what I say is that I truly believe in the values of this nation, as I learned in school, and my families do, and my family do too. And we want to be part of the fabric of society.
Let's talk about tonight. Oh, go ahead.
Yeah, I'm second generation legal immigrant. My grandparents came over from Russia. They came legally.
But the system
Everyone
that we
worked
have
here,
now, it's
the system actually works. We have 1 million immigrants being allowed in and getting green cards every year legally. What we have is Christina and her organization, which I looked on your website, not sure who's funding it, probably La Raza or some other groups like that, but we cannot allow, which is pretty much anyone who can walk across the border to come in here.
Let's come back full circle.
You'll see it in Montgomery County.
Okay.
Yeah.
Maryland, you're talking about. Let's come back full circle to tonight.
Mm-hmm.
Which races are you watching that the outcomes of tonight, which could tip this debate in your favor or against you? Starting with you, Christina Jimenez.
Well, what we know is that this year the map was not good for Democrats or incumbents, and the reality is that all Americans are very frustrated with the gridlock in Congress, not only on immigration for the Latino community, and you know, most Americans actually want a solution on immigration. It's not only that immigrants want a solution on immigration. So from our perspective, it's gonna be important to look at places like Colorado, like the governor's race in Florida, and it will be critical to see whether the decision of the president to delay executive action on immigration is going to have an impact on the number of Latinos that will turn out to vote, and that the actions that will be taken by the president will be meaningful for 2016.
Brad Botwin.
Yeah, it's really the president and the Democrats have been kicking this issue down the road.
Which states?
Same. Colorado, Arkansas. The Senate is going to flip. So I can't think of one Democratic senator who is pushing amnesty as their main objective during this campaign season. Not one.
So if things turn out the way you hope they will tonight, it's good news for you.
It's very
no
matter
good which news. States.
It's very good news.
Brad Botwin of Help Save Maryland and Christina Jimenez of United We Dream. Thank you both very much.
Thank you.
Thanks.
And just in the last few minutes, the polls have closed in three more states, North Carolina, Ohio, and West Virginia. We have a projection to make in the state of West Virginia, the Senate race there. This is a pickup for the Republicans. Shelley Moore Capito, seven-term congresswoman, the daughter of a former governor of that state. Archmore, she has defeated Natalie Tennant, West Virginia's Secretary of State, a former television news anchor. And now another projection in the state of Ohio. Governor John Kasich winning re-election. This is his second term. He came in a crop of Republican governors that year. A number of them have found themselves in hot water seeking re-election. John Kasich apparently easily re-elected because we are able to call that race just as the polls close. So the Republicans, I'm over here at the table with Amy Walter and Stu Rothenberg. So Amy, this West Virginia result, not a surprise at all, but it is a disappointment for Democrats, nevertheless.
Well, it is. And, you know, this is one of those states that a few years ago, if you'd said West Virginia was going to be as red as it was, we would all have been quite surprised. The speed at which West Virginia went from a Democratic state to a Republican state has been pretty dramatic. So Shelley Moore Capito was considered the favorite all along. But again, this is one of those seats that it was because of a Democratic retirement that opened up. And it's
Jay
one of those
opportunities. Jay Rockefeller, long-time Democratic senator.
And it was one of those seats that, you know, Democrats knew that was going to be very tough to hold on to. But you know, a big opportunity for Republicans here to pad their lead, but one of those states that was always going to go Republican.
Why have Democrats, why are they having, Stu, such a hard time in states like West Virginia?
And we already mentioned Kentucky being called for Mitch McConnell. Well, I think the problems in West Virginia and Kentucky are related. Some of it is cultural, where they're more traditional culturally, and the Democratic Party is seen as progressive and wants to change America. The president did terribly in both West Virginia and Kentucky, but certainly coal is a big issue here. The Republicans have been talking about the war on coal. Democrats talk about the war against women. Republicans talk about the war against coal.
Yeah.
It's always a war. And it appears to be having a significant effect here. I was looking at Harlan County, once known as Bloody Harlan because of the coal
this
mining
is in Kentucky.
In southeastern Kentucky, big,
right.
Famous coal area. And I looked at McConnell's margin in 2010 in Harlan County. He defeated Bruce Lunsford 54-46. It was a 6-point race nationally, statewide in 2010. He won by about 8 points. McConnell won by about 8 points in Harlan. right now, with 78% of the vote in Harlan, in the McConnell-Grimes race, Senator Mitch McConnell is winning 73-23.
Wow. Yeah.
The race, that county blew open, and I think it's primarily coal.
A little bit of time left right now. Amy, what about Ohio? I mentioned John Kasich elected in that wave of Republican governors. Some of them having a real hard time. He's less so, apparently, and this is his name is one of the many mentioned for 2016.
Well, absolutely. And he was helped in part by the fact that his Democratic opponent basically imploded in the middle of that campaign. So he's not in the same kind of tough race that somebody like Scott Walker up the street in Wisconsin, who was having a much closer contest. But look, the talk about John Kasich started not so long ago about running for president. This only helps him. Ohio will always be a battleground state. And this is what we're going to be, I think, talking about a lot tonight, which is the states that are the red states that Republicans know that they can win. The cultural piece of this is a part of it. The demographics are another piece of it. Older, whiter voters in West Virginia, Kentucky go to Republicans. But in those swing states, those states like the Wisconsin, the Ohio, the Floridas, we're going to talk about Colorado. Those are the states we're going to be talking a lot about in 2016. Those are the places Republicans really need to make inroads if they're going to have success at the national level.
And we'll have more of a chance to talk about them tonight.
Yeah.
For now, we will see you a little later.
Okay.
Amy and Stu.
Thank you.
Two big issues in this campaign, money and power. Now let's turn to Lisa Desjardins and Domenico Montanaro for a breakdown of where things stand on both of those issues. Starting with you, Domenico, how are we keeping track of the balance of power tonight?
Well, one of the things we want to show you at home tonight, the way we're going to be keeping track, is we have a graphic of the races that we're seeing, where we started off where Democrats have a 34-30 advantage. And now with what's already come in, you can see it's 34-34. Once this gets to that finish line of 50-51, you'll see that that's when we know who's finally taken control of the Senate. So we'll be updating you throughout the night with all of those numbers as we keep tabs, back of the envelope, spreadsheets, low-tech, high-tech, whatever you need. We've got you covered here and online.
Maybe a little gum on the bottom of your shoe, whatever works for you. Lisa, the other thing we're keeping track of course, is how this money is being spent. We already know record amounts of money have been spent this year in this campaign, and a lot of it's being spent on television.
That's right. A ton of it's being spent on television. Domenico and I have looked through the numbers, and I think what a lot of our viewers may not realize, they think of this money as all being spent on these Senate races. Sure, we're talking tens, hundreds of millions of dollars potentially there. But there are also some very expensive ballot initiatives, money being poured in by agricultural interests, for example, in Oregon. Here you see the state ad spending, and I'm actually going to let Domenico talk about that because that's his specialty.
Well, some of the state ad spending here, you can see the North Carolina is the where most of this money has been spent. There have been some interesting ballot initiatives, of course, in North Carolina as well. But you also have $430 million in all that's been spent among these 10 Senate races. So you've got 9 of those 10 races, Lisa.
Right.
You know, you've had Republicans outspend Democrats, and I think that that probably tells us a lot about what's happening as this night goes on. But, you know, North Carolina, other places, some key ballot initiatives.
You mentioned North Carolina. That's really interesting. I was there not long ago, and that's where these two things come together, this idea of the balance of power, which that might be the Rosetta Stone, Domenico, you told me that months ago, and the most expensive Senate race ever.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you know, the most expensive Senate race. But, you know, it's fascinating not to mention just about North Carolina and how much money's been spent there. You know, we haven't even talked about the governor's races. You know, $80 million, sure, that's a lot of money. But look at what's happened in Florida. Look at what's happened in Illinois. More than $100 million been spent in each of those states on ads. And you have very different rules in governor's races. The Republican there in Illinois has spent $26 million of his own money just on that race. So it's a ton of cash going into a lot of
things. Let me jump in with a sort of big picture, interesting thing that came to me last night as I was poring over all these statistics and everything. Look at the NRA. There in Washington state is a ballot initiative which will test background check law in that state. That has a direct effect on gun owners in that state. The NRA only spent about $500,000 there, Gwen. Where the NRA is spending more money, millions more, is on Senate races. So it's fascinating to think that here's a major power on an issue, not spending directly on that issue, but instead choosing to spend on Senate races themselves.
Lisa Desjardins, Domenico Montanaro of our staff will be with you all night long. Thanks.
Got it.
And let's look at another set of issues playing a role this cycle, energy and the environment. In some cases, the battle is over the regulation of power plants and greenhouse gases. In others, it is focused on oil and gas development. One analysis found there have been over 125,000 ads on these topics aired in Senate races. And it has been a core issue in at least seven of those states, including Alaska, Colorado, Iowa, Michigan, Kentucky, North Carolina, and Louisiana. So, what is at stake tonight? Dan Weiss is the director of campaigns for the League of Conservation Voters. His group has spent $25 million plus during this election, more than any other environmental group. And Scott Siegel. He's a partner at the firm of Bracewell and Giuliani, which lobbies on behalf of utilities, power plants, and other energy companies. And we welcome both of you. Scott Siegel, what is at stake? What energy and environmental policies are on the line in this election?
Well, the president has served notice that he assumes his Clean Power Plan, which is the name for the proposed rule for existing power plants, that's a major part of his legacy. And as a result, a lot of studying has been done on what those rules would do. They'd cost $47 billion. They don't do very much to reduce carbon over and above what the power industry has already done by doing some fuel switching to natural gas. So lots of cost, very little benefit. That's a major question. Will the next Senate engage in oversight? Will they legislate regarding this rule? Will they make changes?
And you're saying if it's a Republican Senate, they're more likely to try to
I think the chances are more likely because if there is a more equitable distribution of political leverage so that the Congress can uniformly speak with the president, that is a recipe for actual negotiation on this complex topic.
How do you see this balance changing depending on what happens, Dan Weiss?
Well, first, Senator McConnell has already said that if he's the majority leader, he will use the budget process to try and stop EPA's Clean Power Plan, the first rules ever to reduce carbon pollution from power plants. It's important to remember that Scott, last time he was here, was against reducing mercury and lead poison from power plants. So, of course, he's against reducing carbon pollution, too.
Well, we're here to talk about what's going to happen.
What McConnell has said is he will use the budget process. What that means is he will stick a rider into a must-pass spending bill that the president will have to either sign or veto. And if he vetoes it, it will lead to a shutdown of whatever government agencies are part of that spending bill. What McConnell made clear is he will seek a confrontation with the president over whether or not we're going to reduce carbon pollution from power plants.
And if that happens, who wins?
Well, of course, I don't see it that way. The way I see it is this. This is one of the few opportunities for both parties, for the leadership in the United States Senate and for the President of the United States to act like adults over an issue as important as global climate change. And if they come together and they actually negotiate on the topic, there are changes that can be made to the President's proposal that make it less costly but do not reduce the benefits that are attributable to it. Why wouldn't anyone want to do that? Right now we have gridlock. With more equitable distribution of political authority, we can negotiate, and I think that's important.
And in fact, Dan Weiss, today, the president's press secretary, Josh Earnest, said that look for the president in the next 2 years to exercise more executive action when it comes to dealing with climate change. So what do you look for? Again, whether it is a Democratic, still Democratic-controlled Senate, Republican House, of course, or whether the Senate goes Republican. What do you look for?
Well, the most important thing is that the president is enforcing existing laws passed by Congress, interpreted by the courts, that would require him to reduce carbon pollution, not only from power plants. He's going to be doing it from heavy trucks as well by making their fuel go further on a gallon of gasoline. All of the steps we need to take to reduce climate change can happen over the next few years through the president enforcing the law. Congress
even with a Republican, even if the Senate flips to Republican.
That's right. The other avenue that we have is going to be in the states, where a number of states have taken leadership to reduce their carbon pollution. And with some luck tonight, and we win some seats in Oregon and Washington at the state level, we can have even more leadership from those and other states.
How do you see that?
Well, actually, the states is where a lot of these battles are going on. And what I'll tell you is the rules as currently proposed by this administration, which represent an unprecedented power grab by the federal government, mix up and scramble exactly what the state authorities have been so far. They are topsy-turvy, and frankly, the governor's races will be just as important to determine whether we can even implement these rules. Look, We talk about an unprecedented use of executive authority. And then Dan wonders why the appropriations process, which is the only constitutional power that could possibly combat that, is in play. The answer is obvious.
But I hear both of you saying that a lot of the action is going to be heading to the states anyway, no matter what happens.
That's right.
In Washington.
That's right. And it's important to note that today, President George W. Bush's EPA Administrator, Christy Todd Whitman, endorsed the president's Clean Power Plan. Why? Because it's a flexible mechanism that allows states to set up plans that make sense for them to reduce their carbon pollution. It's not a power grab. What the president is doing is enforcing the law.
I think
as interpreted by the Supreme Court.
I think Dan needs to read that rule a little bit more carefully. It is an unprecedented extension of federal authority into areas that the EPA administrators from Christy Todd Whitman to the present have never had that type of authority and that type of power.
Yes.
It goes down to the very appliances in our homes.
Just very quickly to both of you, Scott Siegel, this report that came out in the last day or so, another global group warning about the dire consequences of climate change. Just quickly, what do you see as an appropriate action on the part of an administration, whether there's a Republican Senate or a Democratic-controlled Senate?
Well, we believe that there are several important parts that I think there would be consensus and support. Improving energy efficiency is one of those. And having the Environmental Protection Agency not sue power plants that are attempting to make improvements in energy efficiency. That's a good start.
And what would you add?
Well, subtract. Well, it's very important to note that the alarm bells keep ringing louder and louder. What we'd like to see is the Republican Party, which had a lot of climate action people in it through 2008, Obama and McCain's climate plans were very similar, stop being a climate science denial party and deny that there's a consensus that humans are responsible for climate change. They are that today, and that's unfortunate.
We are going to have to leave it there. Gentlemen, we thank you for coming in on election night. Both Scott Siegel and Dan Weiss, we thank you both.
Thank you for having me.
Thanks.
So for a roundup of the projected winners, this is what we know so far. Republicans have picked up one seat in their quest to control the Senate. In West Virginia, with a win by Shelley Moore Capito, a Republican taking the seat of retiring Democratic Senator Jay Rockefeller. In Kentucky, Senator Mitch McConnell held on to his seat in a closely watched race. We're still watching to see if he might get the chance to be majority leader. In South Carolina, Republican Senators Lindsey Graham and Tim Scott both won re-election, and Republican Nikki Haley won the governor's race there. And in Ohio, Republican Governor John Kasich won a second term. I have to ask you, Michael Gerson, I wonder if this has to do with the Democrats losing or the Republicans having better candidates.
Well, I think if Republicans win the Senate tonight, it will be because of the primary process by which they weeded out some of the problems they've had in the past with candidates that were not mainstream candidates. You now have really strong people like Ernst and Gardner and others in this. And this is a triumph of the establishment, and it'll shape the view of the election itself. This is not going to be seen as a Tea Party victory if Mitch McConnell gets the position of majority leader. It really has been an establishment victory. They controlled the primary process, and if they win, they will have guaranteed their victory.
I think that take West Virginia. That is a state, when Ronald Reagan defeated Jimmy Carter carried six states. One of them was West Virginia. That's how Democratic West Virginia was.
No Republican has had this seat since 1942.
That's exactly right. And what has happened is there's been no change in West Virginia. There's been no demographic change. There have been people moving in. There's no racial composition change. There isn't a big Latino eviction or infusion. It's a change in the attitudes of toward the Democratic Party, toward the Republican Party, coal, social issues, cultural issues, a sense that the Democrats don't care about us, white working people, and Republicans do speak for us in a strange and bizarre way. But that really is a factor. I do think that the Republican nominating process really served them very well. Joni Ernst was turned out to be lucky for them because she was not their choice
in Iowa.
And she turned out to be a great match for the year. I mean, with ISIS big, here's a woman who's actually served in a combat theater. She's a personally appealing person. She is a Tea Party candidate, though. I mean, her ideology is closer, truly to Michelle Bachmann's than it is to Chuck Grassley's.
And we really don't have any, we don't have any results yet because the polls haven't closed in
That's
Iowa
right.
yet. But Michael, are we talking here, you both have raised the idea that Republicans have better candidates. You've mentioned it a couple times tonight. So is it a balance then? The party has to find the right candidate and has to have the national issue at the same time in that, you know, anti-Washington, anti-Obama?
Yes. I mean, you have to have good candidates in a good year. I mean, there are some good candidates. I think that none in Georgia is a very good candidate and may not be enough in this, in a runoff going forward. And so I think candidate quality matters, but I think the year matters even more. You know, if you're fighting a wave, it's very difficult.
I think people wonder. They look at something like what you said a minute ago, and Mark, you may have mentioned it. When a party looks at what happened to the Republicans last go round in 2012, and they had some candidates who hurt them, mm-hmm. How do you go about weeding those people out? What do you do to make sure you've got good candidates?
I mean, for one thing, the Chamber of Commerce really went in big time and went into primaries. Scott Reed, who ran Bob Dole's campaign for president, was their political honcho, and they backed what they thought was the most winnable candidates.
Hold that thought, Mark, because we're going to come back and talk about it all night long. Mark Shields, Michael Gerson.
We thank you. And that is the NewsHour for now. We want you to stick with us as we live stream our live election coverage online. You can find us at pbs.org/NewsHour. Run to your computer. I'm Judy Woodruff.
And I'm Gwen Ifill. We'll be right back here for a special report at 11 p.m. Eastern Time for all of us here. And there are a lot of us at the PBS NewsHour tonight. Thank you and stay with us.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by Lincoln Financial, committed to helping you take charge of your life and become your own chief life officer. BNSF Railway. And by BAE Systems, inspired work. And with the ongoing support of these institutions.
This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
You're watching PBS.